What is steam? The steam in the steam room is not steam. The steam rising over warm water into cooler air is not steam. Irate managers sometimes let off steam, but that's something else entirely. The mist you see that we normally call steam really isn't. That mist is created as water droplets condense out of cooling steam and fall as a precipitate. You cannot see steam. It is as clear as glass. Yet, this invisible steam is one of the best agents known for taking heat from a source in one location so that it can perform some service at another. Steam is created when sufficient heat has been added to water to change it to the gaseous state. All the heat used to vaporize the water is stored in the steam. In a steam system, the expanding vapor pressurizes the boiler, pushing the steam out through the pipes to some remote location, where a device is used to foster the release of the stored heat to some process or product, condensing the steam back to water. Everyone viewing this tape works with steam routinely and is probably already familiar with all the concepts we will discuss. What we hope to do is present a new way of looking at the science behind steam, a more visual approach to steam basics. To begin, we need to agree upon a few definitions. Temperature is a measure of how fast the individual molecules of a substance are moving. Hotter temperatures indicate faster movement. Heat is a form of energy which in turn is a measurement of the ability to do work. The amount of heat in a material is calculated from both the temperature and the quantity of the material. A large cool lake may contain more heat than a hot tub, for instance. Heat is measured in British thermal units, or BTUs. One BTU is the amount of heat required to raise 1 pound of cold water 1 degree Fahrenheit. Standard pressure is the atmospheric pressure at sea level, about 14.7 pounds per square inch above an absolute vacuum. Steam is usually measured in gauge pressure, or pounds per square inch above standard. The measurement of the amount of space a substance occupies is called its specific volume. Now, with this information in mind, let's follow the trail of the heat. On a pool table, energy is transferred from the cue ball to the less active object balls when they collide. When water is heated, the heat energy moves similarly from molecule to molecule. Heat always flows from a higher temperature level to a lower temperature level. In a teapot, heat from the flame is conducted to the water where it excites the molecules. As the molecules vibrate faster and faster, the temperature rises. Between freezing and boiling, the heat of the liquid is directly related to its temperature. Therefore, this is referred to as sensible heat. At any pressure, it takes a specific amount of sensible heat to raise the temperature of the water from 32 degrees Fahrenheit to the boiling temperature. This is called the heat of the saturated liquid. At standard pressure, the heat of the saturated liquid of water is about 180 BTUs per pound, and the boiling temperature is 212 degrees Fahrenheit. The water temperature will not rise above the boiling point, even though more heat is added. An old camping trick is to hold a paper cup full of water over an open flame. Once the water in the cup reaches the boiling point, the temperature of the water will not rise any further. As long as water remains, it keeps the surrounding cup near 212 degrees, well below the burning temperature of the paper. Heat added after the boiling point has been reached works to change the state of the water. The water vaporizes when enough energy has been added to break the bonds that hold the molecules of water together as a liquid. Since the added heat cannot be detected by measuring the water temperature, it is referred to as latent heat. The amount of latent heat that must be added to change the state of the water is called the heat of vaporization. At standard pressure, the heat of vaporization is about 970 BTUs per pound of water. The total amount of heat in steam is determined by adding the sensible and latent heat. The total heat in steam at standard pressure is approximately 1150 BTUs. When a substance vaporizes, its specific volume increases greatly. When grease is spattered from a hot pan, it is the result of water droplets in the grease reaching the heat of vaporization and suddenly exploding into steam. At standard pressure, steam occupies approximately 1,600 times the volume of water. Whereas 1 pound of water occupies 2 cups, 1 pound of steam fills more than 77 feet of 8-inch pipe. Thus far, we have been talking about water at standard pressure. As the pressure changes, so do the various properties of the water. One way to look at it is that an increase in pressure holds the water molecules more strongly together. Greater energy is required to bring the liquid to a point where it will vaporize. This energy is indicated by a higher boiling temperature, and therefore an increased heat of the saturated liquid. With a greater amount of energy present in the water, less latent heat needs to be added to alter the molecular bonds and turn the liquid to a gas. Increased pressure also means greater opposition to the separating molecules as the water vaporizes, resulting in a smaller increase in the steam volume than occurs at standard pressure. The effect of changing pressure on steam temperature, the heat of the saturated liquid, the heat of vaporization, the total heat of the steam, and specific volume are recorded on a table called the Thermodynamic Properties of Steam, a standard industry reference. If a specific temperature is required for a process, the tables show the pressure at which that temperature occurs. The specific volume column can be used for flow rate calculations. The latent heat column best indicates why steam is such a good heating agent. All of the latent heat is released immediately when the steam condenses. At standard pressure, collapsing steam releases 970 BTUs per pound. In contrast, 1 pound of water at 212 degrees releases only 1 BTU as it cools to 211. The condensing steam gives up almost 1,000 times as much heat as the water without any change in temperature. To see how the dynamics of pressure, temperature, and heat function, we'll build a model steam system. This boiler generates steam at 100 PSIG to ensure adequate steam flow through the system by virtue of the relatively low volume of 100-pound steam. The 100 PSIG steam has a temperature of 338 degrees Fahrenheit, adequate to supply the 300 degrees necessary for the batch heater and drum dryer in the system. The remainder of the system is used primarily for the transfer of heat rather than producing a specific temperature, so we reduce the pressure to 50 PSIG. While the temperature at this pressure is only 298 degrees, there is more latent heat available for transfer. As the steam moves through the piping and equipment, it gives up its heat and, of course, condenses. Good condensate management is a necessity in an efficient steam system. As we've pointed out, condensate has much less heat to transfer than steam, so it should be removed from the system. In addition, if it is returned to the boiler while still hot, it conserves fuel. Condensate remaining in the tubes impedes the transfer of heat from the steam. When water coats your mirror as you shave, it interferes with the light traveling to and from the mirror surface. When it coats the inside of a heat exchanger, it interferes with the heat traveling from the steam to the transfer surface. If the condensate is allowed to accumulate, it begins to rob the system of steam space and to prevent heat transfer from the steam. In cold weather, condensate buildup can freeze, blocking or splitting pipes, valves, and other hardware. In a warmer environment, accumulating condensate may cause water hammer. In a percolator, water is forced up the center tube by the difference in pressure between the steam at the bottom of the tube and the air at the top. Likewise, in a steam system, a large accumulation of condensate can block a pipe. This causes the steam downstream of the plug to cool and collapse. Steam pressure upstream accelerates the plug down the pipe, picking up more water along the way until it is stopped by an elbow, T, or valve. Another type of water hammer occurs when steam bubbles are trapped in a pocket of cool condensate. The steam collapses, leaving a vacuum into which the surrounding condensate rushes at nearly the speed of sound. The condensate impacts at the center of the void and transmits shock waves to any surrounding components. On a larger scale, the same phenomenon can occur much more slowly. If steam condenses faster than it can be replaced by the boiler, the pressure in a closed system will drop slowly. If the situation persists, the pressure will fall below atmospheric, forming a vacuum. A vacuum will impede normal flow inside a steam system. The pressure dynamics can work in the opposite way, too. Opening the radiator cap on a hot automobile can be very dangerous. That's because the pressurized coolant may be hotter than its boiling point at atmospheric pressure. In a steam system, flash steam occurs when sufficiently hot condensate is released into a lower pressure line. While some systems are designed to use flash steam for lower pressure service, its occurrence can impede efficient system operation. Proper air management is as important to operating efficiency as condensate management. If you heat water in an open pan, you'll notice that long before it boils, bubbles begin to rise to the surface. Air is trapped in practically all water. In a steam system, it is released in the boiler as the water vaporizes. The air can plate out to coat the inside surface of the heat exchangers, where it can interfere with heat transfer in the same way that condensate does. Accumulations of air can impede steam flow and condensate evacuation, lowering steam system efficiency and promoting water hammer. Air also reduces the operating temperature inside the system. When air mixes with steam, the pressure in the system is a sum of the individual pressures of the two gases. The temperature, however, is determined only by the pressure of the steam, called a partial pressure, not the total pressure. The resulting temperature of an air-steam mix is always lower than the temperature of pure steam at the same pressure. Free carbon dioxide is another gas that can be trapped in water. It can also be released into the system from carbonates in the boiling water. Cooling condensate condenses and mixes with the carbon dioxide to form carbonic acid, a corrosive. Good air management consists of proper waterside treatment and the elimination of air in the system as it is formed. In quick review, a burner adds heat to the water and the water temperature rises. The heated liquid reaches the boiling point and vaporizes, turning to steam and releasing air and carbon dioxide into the system. In the process of expanding, the steam stores latent heat and pressurizes the system, forcing the steam through piping to its destination. Steam condenses in the distribution lines and as it gives up its heat at the exchanger to accomplish some task. The condensate and any air in the system must be removed immediately so that they do not impede system efficiency. The information in this tape forms a necessary foundation for any discussion of steam system design or management. A thorough understanding and careful application of these principles will help you minimize system problems and maximize system efficiency.